Random House Audio presents Chasing Venus, The Race to Measure the Heavens, by Andrea Wulf. Read for you by Robin Sachs. The planet Venus, drawn from her seclusion, modestly delineating on the sun, without disguise, her real magnitude, whilst her disk, at other times so lovely, is here obscured in melancholy gloom. Jeremiah Horrocks. We must show that we are better, and that science has done more to humankind than divine or sufficient grace. Denis Diderot. Author's note. In the interests of clarity and consistency, I have retained certain place names of the viewing stations as the transit astronomers referred to them in the 18th century. Instead of the modern Puducherry, for example, I have used Pondicherry, Bencoolen instead of Bengkulu, Madras instead of Chennai, Constantinople instead of Istanbul. In some rare cases where the old names have fallen completely out of use, I have taken the modern name, Jakarta instead of Batavia, for example. Prologue. The Gauntlet. The ancient Babylonians called her Ishtar. To the Greeks, she was Aphrodite, and to the Romans, Venus, goddess of love, fertility, and beauty. She is the brightest star in the night sky and visible even on a clear day. Some saw her as the harbinger of morning and evening, of new seasons or portentous times. She reigns as the morning star or the bringer of light for 260 days, and then disappears to rise again as the evening star and the bringer of dawn. Venus has inspired people for centuries, but in the 1760s, astronomers believed that the planet held the answer to one of the biggest questions in science. She was the key to understanding the size of the solar system. In 1716, British astronomer Edmund Halley published a 10-page essay which called upon scientists to unite in a project spanning the entire globe, one that would change the world of science forever. On 6 June 1761, Halley predicted Venus would traverse the face of the sun. For a few hours, the bright star would appear as a perfectly black circle. He believed that measuring the exact time and duration of this rare celestial encounter would provide the data that astronomers needed in order to calculate the distance between the Earth and the Sun. The only problem was that the so-called transit of Venus is one of the rarest predictable astronomical events. Transits always arrive in pairs, 8 years apart, but with an interval of more than a century before they are then seen again. Only once before, Halley said, in 1639, had an astronomer called Jeremiah Horrocks observed the event. The next pair would occur in 1761 and 1769, and then again in 1874 and 1882. Because the orbits of Venus and Earth have different inclinations, Venus usually passes above or below the Sun, and therefore cannot be seen from the Earth. The periods between the pairs of transits alternate between 105 and 122 years. The first transit of Venus observed by an astronomer was on 4th December 1639. The next transits were on 6th June 1761, 3rd June 1769, 9th December 1874, and 6th December 1882. There was no transit in the 20th century, but two in the 21st, on 8th June 2004 and 6th June 2012. It will be another 105 years until the transit of 11th December, 2117. Halley was 60 years old when he wrote his essay and knew that he would not live to see the transit unless he reached the age of 104, but he wanted to ensure that the next generation would be fully prepared. Writing in the Journal of the Royal Society, the most important scientific institution in Britain, Halley explained exactly why the event was so important, what these young astronomers had to do, and where they should view it. By choosing to write in Latin, the international language of science, he hoped to increase the chances of astronomers from across Europe acting upon his idea. The more people he reached, the greater the chance of success. It was essential, Halley explained, that several people at different locations across the globe should measure the rare heavenly rendezvous at the same time. It was not enough to see Venus's march from Europe alone. Astronomers would have to travel to remote locations in both the northern and southern hemispheres to be as far apart as possible. And only if they combined these results, the northern viewings being the counterpart to the southern observations, could they achieve what had hitherto been almost unimaginable, a precise mathematical understanding of the dimensions of the solar system, the holy grail of astronomy. Halley's request would be answered when hundreds of astronomers joined in the Transit project. They came together in the spirit of the Enlightenment. The race to observe and measure the transit of Venus was a pivotal moment in a new era, one in which man tried to understand nature through the application of reason. This was a century in which science was worshipped, and myth at last conquered by rational thought. Man began to order the world according to these new principles. The Frenchman Denis Diderot, for example, was amassing all available knowledge for his monumental encyclopédie. The Swedish botanist Carl Linnaeus classified plants according to their sexual organs, and in 1751 Samuel Johnson imposed order upon language when he had compiled the first English dictionary. As new inventions such as microscopes and telescopes opened up previously unknown worlds, scientists were able to zoom in on the minutiae of life and gaze into infinity. Robert Hooke had peered through his microscope to produce detailed engravings of magnified seeds, fleas, and worms. He was the first to call the basic unit of biological life a cell. In the North American colonies, Benjamin Franklin was experimenting with electricity and lightning rods, controlling what until then had been regarded as manifestations of divine fury. Slowly, the workings of nature became clearer. Comets were no longer viewed as portents of God's wrath, but as Halley had shown, predictable celestial occurrences. In 1755, the German philosopher Immanuel Kant suggested that the universe was much larger than his contemporaries believed, and that it consisted of uncountable and gigantic Welteninseln, cosmic islands, or galaxies. Humankind believed it was marching along a trajectory of progress. Scientific societies were founded in London, Paris, Stockholm, St. Petersburg, and in the North American colonies in Philadelphia, to explore and exchange this newfound knowledge. Observation, inquiry, and experimentation were the building blocks of this new understanding of the world. With progress as the leading light of the century, every generation envied the next. Whereas the Renaissance had looked back upon the past as the Golden Age, the Enlightenment looked firmly to the future. Halley's idea of using the transit of Venus as a tool to measure the heavens was born out of developments in astronomy over the previous century. Until the early 17th century, man had observed the sky with his naked eye, but technology was slowly catching up with the reach of his ambitions and theories. Astronomy had changed from a science which mapped stars to one which sought to understand the motion of planetary bodies. In the early 16th century, Nicolaus Copernicus had proposed the revolutionary idea of the solar system with the sun rather than the earth at the center, and the other planets moving around it, a model that had been expanded and verified by Galileo Galilei and Johannes Kepler in the early 17th century. But it was Isaac Newton's groundbreaking Principia in 1687 which had defined the underlying universal laws of motion and gravity that ruled all and everything. As astronomers gazed at the stars, they were no longer in search of God, but of the laws governing the universe. By the time Halley called upon his fellow astronomers to view the transit of Venus, the universe was regarded as running like a divinely created clockwork, according to laws which humankind had only to comprehend and compute. The position and movements of planets were no longer seen as ordained arbitrarily by God, but as ordered and predictable, and based on natural laws. But man still lacked the knowledge of the actual size of the solar system, an essential piece of the celestial jigsaw puzzle. Understanding the dimensions of the heavens had always been a principal object of astronomical inquiry, the American astronomer and Harvard professor John Winthrop said in the Transit Decade. Already in the early 17th century, Kepler had discovered that by knowing how long it took for a planet to orbit the Sun, the relative distance between the Sun and the planet could be calculated. The longer it took a planet to orbit the Sun, the further away it was. This was Kepler's third law, which said that the square of the orbital period of a planet is directly proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis of its orbit. In simpler terms, it means that Kepler had provided a mathematical formula which could be used to calculate the relative distances in the solar system by using the radius of a planet and the time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.